Hello friends, good morning to all of you. In continuation of my lectures on chemistry of vitamins, today we'll discuss about vitamin D2 or ergocalciferol. So if we see the history of vitamin D2, Dr. Daniel Wiesler and Professor Francis Glisson are the first to identify or describe technically some bony deformation which is actually arising because of food habits. Especially it is observed in those people who are feeding on starch or otherwise protein rich food which is less in lipids. In 1824, several doctors worked on it, but in 1824 Dr. D. Shuttle and Dr. Kubli proposed cod liver oil as a treatment for this bony disorder by name rickets or otherwise and osteomalacia. Sir Frederick Gowland Hopkins, the father of vitamins, he actually proposed that vitamins have an important role to play as far as maintenance of health is concerned. They are essential for our body. And Casimir Funk has done extensive work on relation between the role of individual vitamins and their role in maintenance of our health, and he has published extensively. Sir Edward Mellanby is key person in the in scientific study of role of vitamin D's in formation of pathogenesis of rickets, and he actually proposed that he has actually scientifically proven that rickets is because of the lack of fat, as if a fat soluble vitamin, and he proposed cod liver oil as a treatment to cure rickets. And later on, surprisingly, a scientist Kurt Hrdinsky found a very interesting observation. Like he found like UV rays can also cure rickets, and inspired by this observation, Professor Harry Steinbeck has done a lot of research work in UV irradiation of biomolecules where vitamin D2 was actually obtained from irradiation of ergosterol. And Hess and Weinstock in the same period, they got vitamin D3 via irradiation of the skin. So this has actually confirmed there is something so unique relation between UV rays and your skin, so that from skin chemistry the skin is actual producer of the vitamin. So these are the observations, some of the observations which helped lay foundations for development of vitamin D chemistry. Professor Adolf Windaus has done extensive research work on steroids, and one of the research work for his team is like the relation between steroids and vitamin D family, vitamin D, and he was awarded Nobel Prize in 1928 for his studies on steroids and their relation to vitamins. Dr. Dorothy Crawford Hodgkin, she studied the structure of 3D structure of vitamin D2 and provided X-ray crystallography structure of vitamin D2 in the year 1948. It is in fact her PhD work. She was awarded later on for her studies on vitamin B12. She was awarded Nobel Prize in 1963. So friends, let's see the isolation of vitamin D. Please remember that isolation technology that is available right now and that was available at that time are completely different. Okay, so isolation of a lipid molecule from an oil is a Herculean task that itself needs a lot of work. So here, let's see, cod liver oil was taken. And it was saponified because cod liver oil contains so much of fixed oils. So to remove them, saponified with methanol and KOH. And the environment is nitrogen environment, because vitamin D2 is susceptible to oxidative degradation. Then the saponifier, after saponification, because saponified fat is removed, washed, and unsaponified fat is taken into ether layer, and in the unsaponified fat you will have, because cod liver oil is a very rich resource not only for vitamin D, it is also a very rich resource for vitamin A. Now a lipid has to be separated from another lipid. Okay, so how can you remove it? So the second lipid, because vitamin A is known to possess so many double bonds, okay, so conjugated double bonds will be there, so that's so many double bonds will be there. So what they did is they used malic anhydride in appropriate proportions so that malic anhydride form adducts with vitamin A, thereby vitamin A chemistry or otherwise physicochemical properties are altered so that its polarity changes. Thus we can remove it. Then what is it that we got is a mixture of vitamin D and the remaining unsaponifiable material like steroids. Upon column chromatography, vitamin D2 is found always mixed with steroids, monohydroxysteroids. That is again another big headache. Vitamin D plus sterol mixer was treated with digitonin. So digitonin has the capacity to interact with the steroids and form complexes. So thereby they could separate steroids from this mixture. Now they have taken vitamin D and esterified in the presence of ethanol and acid to obtain vitamin D esters. So these vitamin D esters were then separated, saponified to obtain D family vitamins, which upon recrystallization they could get vitamin D2. So this is the way how they developed an isolation methodology by using different type of strategies to finally obtain a very pure vitamin D2, because obtaining pure sample of a natural product decides the success or failure of structural elucidation, because unless you have a pure sample in your hand you will not be able to go further. Vitamin D2 is a solid material, it's a crystalline solid, its melting point is 115 to 117 degrees centigrade, and it's also an optically active substance with optical rotation, dextrorotatory and 130 degrees. Now let's see chemistry of vitamin D2. Molecular formula of vitamin D2 is found to be C28H44NO. So this is so surprising that at that time when Professor Windass was working with steroids, he was surprised to see that the molecular formula exactly matches with ergosterol, and that actually indicated that these two are some kind of an isomers. Then vitamin D2 was taken and then subjected to routine chemical tests, where he found the compound is forming an ester with both benzoyl chloride as well as acetyl chloride. So these two clearly indicated that the compound is actually possessing a monohydric alcohol. Then what type of alcohol is it, primary, secondary or tertiary? The best way how we can determine that one is by simple oxidation. Upon oxidation, they found like the compound is forming a ketone. A ketone can be obtained from only a secondary alcohol. So this is the way how they confirmed presence of a monohydric alcohol, and that too it is a secondary alcohol. The structure, because the same kind of features are available in ergosterol also. And then upon hydrogenation, here they got a very critical information regarding structure of vitamin D2. Here upon hydrogenation, it consumed 4 moles of hydrogen to give a compound with molecular formula C28H52O. So 4 double bonds are there. Okay, that's fine. But in ergosterol, how many double bonds are there? Only 3 double bonds are there. But if you see the molecular formula C28H52NO, and when you do the unsaturations,
When you calculate for number of unsaturations, it is giving you three unsaturations are still there. It means that three rings are there. What does it indicate? It indicates that in case of ergosterol, we have four rings and three double bonds. Whereas here, we have four double bonds and three rings. So there is something is happening. So one of the ring that is present in ergosterol might get degraded or otherwise something else is happening. So thereby, vitamin D2 is somewhat structurally related to ergosterol. So these are the indications that are obtained from these tests. Ozonolysis is the best method one can use on terpenes or otherwise carboskeletons wherever double bonds are there, because ozonolysis is a very clean reaction which can cleave across C double bond C to give us aldehydes or ketones. So here, upon degradation, ozonolysis, the compound vitamin D2 gave formaldehyde and 2,3-dimethylbutanol and a ketone whose structure is elucidated. So here, if you see this fragment and formaldehyde this 5-membered ring, so this one, cyclopentane ring, so this indicated that a compound vitamin D2 possesses structural features similar to ergosterol. The side chain product, because ergosterol also upon ozonolysis has provided the same 2,3-dimethylbutanol, it indicated that there is a possibility of presence of this side chain as well as a couple of rings over here in the structure of vitamin D2. Further, here they have done the second oxidative degradation reaction with dilute KMnO4, because KMnO4 is a very good reagent, because if you change the strength of KMnO4 as well as external conditions like acidic, basic, neutral, dilute, concentrated, or upon heating, boiling at room temperature, below room temperature, if you alter the conditions, its oxidizing capacity can be altered. So they used KMnO4 reagent and oxidized to obtain several fragments, but among all, these are the fragments which helped in obtaining clear indication about presence of, see this fragment and this fragment. So this is the first indication where vitamin D2 has the side chain similar to ergosterol. One, the second one is ergosterol, because if you have four rings, this is A ring, this is B ring, this is C ring, and this is D ring. In vitamin D2 and ergosterol, the C D ring structure is also retained. So the entire structure is retained. And here, if you see the fragment, we have a double bond O here. And double bond C double bond C CHO is here. So definitely this aldehyde upon oxidative degradation definitely will give you this ketone. Hence there is a, because this aldehyde can form only when there is a double bond moving from over here like this. So one of the ring, means the C ring got degraded. Okay, C ring got degraded like this. And then A ring is there separately, but they could not isolate the A ring because of its very small structure and it got degraded all the time. So that's why they could not isolate this one. And they proposed there is a possibility of degradation of the B ring, okay, and the angular methyl group over here, this is the angular methyl group, can become an alkene, exocyclic methylene. Okay, so this is their proposal, because this is the only way via which you can have formaldehyde. Okay, because all the remaining structure, including this methyl group, because you cannot keep any other methyl group anywhere. The only methyl group that we have, or a carbon that can come out, is possible only over here. So that's the reason why they propose the angular methyl group has become exocyclic methylene group. So this is the proposal, this is the final proposal they have given. Now what is it that we have to do? We have to find out a proof for this structure. a proof for this structure. So the major reaction which gave strong proof, evidence for the presence of this structure is malic anhydride adduct formation. Because in case of malic anhydride, it can react with conjugated double bonds via a reaction. We know this one, okay? What is the name of this reaction? Can you tell me? Diels-Alder reaction, adduct formation, okay? So this is reacting with this is a diene and dienophile react with each other to give you an adduct. And upon adduct formation, they got this compound. And this compound upon selenium dehydrogenation gave naphthalene. They did not elucidate the structure of this compound, okay? I am giving it over here just as a representation so that you will understand how actually we can get this compound. And then in palladium catalyzed hydrogenation, they got naphthalene and naphthalene carboxylic acid. So this is possible only when malic anhydride attacks this double bond, okay? So we have like this, one double bond is like this and the second double bond is like this. So across the structure, malic anhydride is attacking to give you that, then only there is a possibility of formation of this cyclodecane bicyclic ring, and that upon dehydrogenation can give you naphthalene. So this is the first proof evidence they got. The next one is we have seen this one, okay? Partial hydrogenation and ozonolysis gave them this compound fragment, okay? This confirmed degradation of A and C ring across B ring. Further, vitamin D2 upon ozonolysis, this we know, and oxidative degradation is giving all these, because the structure proposed over here is supporting all these reactions of ozonolysis degradation as well as oxidative degradation. So this is the way how they could get all kinds of evidence to support their proposed structure. Now what we have to do? We need to synthesize it, okay? And friends, for your information, vitamin D2 complete synthesis was not achieved because it could be obtained directly from natural resource. Now let's see. In synthesis, vitamin D2 or D2 congeners like vitamin D2, D3, D4, D5, all these are obtained from one or the other kind of a natural product, naturally available steroids. For example, 7-dehydrocholesterol upon UV exposure has provided cholecalciferol or vitamin D3. And 22-23-dihydroergosterol provides vitamin D4. And 7-dehydrocytosterol gave vitamin D5. Okay, so this is the way how Professor Windass got all kinds of vitamin D family, D family vitamins from one or the other type of steroids with conjugated double bonds present in B ring. And one more synthesis is achieved from, it's more like a semi-synthetic reaction only. The fragment they got in the KMNO4 degradation of vitamin D2 was used, and then say they synthesized ergocalciferol or vitamin D2. So this is the reaction, we call it as Wittig reaction. So friends, vitamin D2, because we all knew that sun rays help us in gaining vitamin D, okay? So how it is obtained? Because upon exposure to sun, provitamin D2, okay, converts itself to vitamin D, and this further is integrated into cell chemistry. how it is integrated, let's see. Its role in biological system is, right now, a lot of information is available regarding, so much of studies have happened regarding vitamin D2 or D family vitamins and their role in health. All we knew so far is their role in calcium, the maintenance of calcium levels in our body. It starts from absorption to distribution to deposition on bones. Okay, so here vitamin D role is established. Along with that, scientists found its role in maintenance of health of a cell. Its lack actually is connected to cancer and heart health of heart or cardiovascular system, and functioning of immune system, functioning of muscle as well as brain. In case of muscle, you can see, okay, muscles function via contraction and relaxation, which needs calcium. Okay, so when vitamin D2 is not there, calcium reserves concentration is going to alter, and that may result in deregulated functioning of calcium mediated signaling mechanisms. Wherever they are there, they are not going to function properly. So this is the way how vitamin D plays a very, very important role in our body in maintenance of our health. So friends, I hope you got some information regarding vitamin D2, and I hope you understood the chemistry of vitamin D2, how actually they used all kinds of logics, okay, to derive the structure of vitamin D2 from the existing knowledge of ergosterol. Friends, if you like this video, please share it with your friends, and please subscribe to my YouTube channel. I'll see you again with another very, very interesting lecture soon.